I want to do some testing to see how well wood screws hold in wood. And I've been using this setup to do tension testing with my screw jack, and that actually worked up to half a ton, but it's just not stiff enough. So I want to make a better setup using these pieces of hardwood. First, I need a groove for this board to go on here. And I'll just cut that with a ball nose bit on my router table. So that will push on here, and I can be fairly sure that the force is applied right here. Now the top beam also needs a notch for that board, but that needs to be offset into the beam. And the top part of my screw jack is going to need to be able to pivot here. So I've got a round bit on here, so make sure the force applies in the middle. These locating pins help me position the screw jack base exactly on here so that the center is right there, and these load cells measure the force that the screw jack applies. Now I need some holes here and here to pull from. Now this bolt can pivot in here a little bit, and I even rounded it to make sure it pivots nicely in the middle. And the depth of that hole is such that it's in line with this and this to make sure that this lever always doubles the force of the jack onto this bolt here. Now with the old setup, if the specimen fails spontaneously, this top beam from all the tension built up into it wanted to go flying, so let's see if this one's going to go flying. And for safety, I got it tied to the ceiling. Oh, that was disappointing. Oh, I just can't get a sample that fails spectacularly when I want one. So that can pivot on here a little bit now without the ability to jump out of the slot. I added another screw on here that keeps this beam from flying off if the tension is released too fast, and a few more screws to hold this U-channel in place and to make sure my jack is always pushing at the center of this beam. Now this jack, I think I've taken it up to about 350 kilograms, which means with this beam doubling the force, I could potentially pull 700 kilograms here. But if I move the screw to the 1/3 point, I haven't drilled a hole yet, that means I'd be tripling the force, which means I could be pulling a ton right here. But the question is, could this cause the wood to split here? And maybe I should put some reinforcing screws in there? But would those screws be strong enough? Well, let's do an experiment to find out. Got a 1/8 inch pilot hole and a drywall screw to go in here. So that took 383 kilograms for that drywall screw to pop out. And that's in 19 millimeter or 3/4 inch thick stock with a 1/8 inch pilot hole. And now let's try it again with a smaller pilot hole, this time 7/64 of an inch. I could hear that starting to yield before it pulled out, the screw is intact. On the graph, you can see the force started to drop a little bit, and the maximum was 454 kilograms before it yielded. And the screw threads themselves are completely undamaged. And now a piece of sugar maple, which is harder than the Norway maple I was testing with before. This one started creeping out rather gently, and at 387 kilograms, that was actually a little bit less than the Norway maple. All that hold of the threads in the wood doesn't do much good if the screw head can't support it, so let's test that. I am counting on these machine screw threads holding fairly well in this piece of hardwood. see the head starting to sink in a little bit. Okay, and I think we just, we pulled out of the bottom piece here. Now these drywall screws have sort of a trumpet-shaped head like this versus a conical head for regular countersink screws. Now the same size screw as this one would actually be this one, which has got a much smaller head. So instead I'm going to compare it to the next size up of countersink screw. This is the number 8 screw, which has got the same diameter head as the drywall screw. So at 264 kilograms, it's definitely sinking in. We're just sinking further and further in. And that head is way, way down now. So I'm continuing this test because the force, surprisingly, continues to increase just a little bit. I think until it pulls out on the other side. And what happened now? Looking down here from the splinters around here, it's clear the screw pulled out of the bottom piece there, which is surprising. I thought it would hold better because it's a bigger diameter screw than this drywall screw. Although I did, of course, have to make a slightly bigger pilot hole too because that screw is just bigger. Now, how do I get that sunken screw back out? I've got an idea here. These four drywall screws should provide more than a ton of reinforcement against splitting right here, but then I thought maybe this hole might pop out the bottom, so I added four more drywall screws here. Now it is a bit of a mystery why this smaller drywall screw held better than the slightly larger countersink screw, so I figure it must have been the pilot hole, so I've got three different sizes of pilot hole that I'm going to try this screw with. Testing with a 9/64 inch pilot hole. 1/8 inch pilot hole. Smallest 7/64 inch pilot. And another test with the smallest 7/64 inch pilot hole. I tabulated my results and they seemed to vary quite a lot, so I ran a third on each test and graphing those. This is the largest pilot hole and this is the smallest. Random variations seem to be much more dominant than pilot hole size. And then looking at the screw diameter and pilot hole size, I calculate the thread penetration. So for the 9/64, the largest is 0.29 millimeters, and for the smallest is 0.69 millimeters. So quite a lot of change in thread penetration. So it's really quite surprising that that made so little difference in terms of pullout force. I cut open my piece of wood to have a look what's going on, and I have a little bit of burning from cutting really slowly. But if we have a really close look at that, you can see how the fibers really curve up around where the thread is. So the failure isn't so much the thread shearing off, but the surrounding wood kind of bending and failing that way. And I guess given that, it's no surprise that the actual thread depth didn't matter that much. So I was curious how pilot hole size would affect softwood, and I also made an improved screw yanking bracket, which is much more convenient. 153 kilograms on that one. The results with the spruce were much more consistent, so I only ran two samples of each hole size. And looking at a graph of those, you can see beyond a 7/64 inch pilot hole size, the strength didn't really increase that much by making the holes smaller. And 7/64 of an inch is also the minor diameter of the thread, so in terms of pilot hole, there's no point in going any smaller than the minor diameter of the screw thread. Although with no pilot hole, it was a little bit stronger, but then you risk splitting the wood. The strength is also less than half as much because with the hardwood I was between 400 and 500 and here I'm way down here. And looking at my test piece of wood, the failures seem to be much more localized than they were with the hardwood. And having just cut that open, there is actually some bending of the fibers near the holes. Not so much in this one because that was the largest 9/64 pilot hole, so it just sheared off. This was the smallest pilot hole and you can see some bending around here. And a test that I didn't film, these two screws have the same major and minor diameter, but this one's got about twice as many threads. So I yanked both of these out of softwood a few times, and the pull force was almost the same. If anything, the finer thread had maybe 5% more force before it came out. But then again, this one is probably easier to drive and is less likely to split the wood.
So that's probably way more than you ever wanted to hear about how much pilot hole size matters in terms of yanking fasteners out of wood. But to me, it was interesting, and I plan on doing more tests with this setup, yanking different types of fasteners out of wood and see what the results are.